Hello, good morning. Welcome to everyone. We're about to start. Well, we've been in two very intense days of debates and visits and cultural activities, and we are facing our last day of the symposium. In this second panel discussion, which is devoted to solidarity and the power of art, an issue not free from controversy, we are going to face this marriage and this strange relationship. When we were preparing the panel, we had a meeting and raised the question of the definition of solidarity. In these 2 days, we have listened to different approaches, like, for example, Mr. Rogulski that defined solidarity as bond, for example, or Piotr Naimski, and he was explaining as the Polish trade union of the 80s. And according to the definition of the dictionaries, the words that resonate the most are unity and support for common interest, which says a lot and probably nothing at the same time. In this panel, we are going to find out and reflect about different prisms and perspectives of treating solidarity by art means, regarding to its mediating role between remembrance, solidarity, resistance, and its social significance, its presumed capacity of censorship and give voice to oppressed and marginalized, or its social responsibility. Let me introduce the first panelist, and I apologize in advance for the pronunciation of your names. Our first speaker will be, according to the program, we have Simon Krbec. Welcome. He's a coordinator of the project of the Theresienstadt Center of Genocide Studies. He has dedicated and actively participated in a number of outreach and educational programs in the area of commemorating the history of genocidal violence. Simon, the floor is yours.
Okay, good morning. So first of all, I thank the organizers for the opportunity to speak here at this very important conference. In my presentation, I will briefly inform you about the ways of using art in the activities of our center. This presentation was made by me and my colleague Pavel Chalupa, who is the director of arts programs in our center. So, first of all, let me briefly introduce our center. I'm representing the Archaeology of Evil Research Center, the NGO, which was established in 2012 as the independent and non-profit organization with the aim to promote research and teaching about the causes, origins, and consequences of genocidal violence throughout the history of mankind. Since 2017, the center is located in the main fortress of Theresienstadt, Theresien, the former Jewish ghetto and transit camp located close to Prague in the Czech Republic. And in the same year, we launched the project called the Theresienstadt Center for Genocide Studies, and we are based now in the Wieser's house, which picture you can see. Oh, thanks. So our main activities are focused on education and awareness raising, including education for the university students. We took the first course in genocide studies in the Czech Republic. We have been also active in adoption of a resolution by the Parliament of the Czech Republic in 2017, which we call it the genocide resolution, and we established a permanent exhibition with virtual reality as well in 2018, and our main focus is the non-formal educational programs, mainly for high school and elementary schools pupils. The use of art in our center is very wide and multiple. We use art basically for the educational purposes and public awareness raising activities, and mainly for genocide prevention. We understand art and we use art as a universal communicator, which is based on authentic experience for the target groups, and also it contains the emotional component, which is very important for us, because the victims in our programs in which we use art are not some numbers in the statistics of genocide, but they are the literary and dramatic characters. And as we know that art was widely used in the genocidal campaigns and ideology, we also understand our use of art as the rehabilitation of art. Here is the list of art forms which we use. Of course, visual arts and exhibition projects, theater and drama, literature, music, classical, traditional, as well as modern, and multimedia installations, including the virtual reality modeling. So now I will show you some examples of our use of art or of our artistic projects and programs. This is the photo exhibition of the Holocaust survivors made by photographer with a Czech Vietnamese photographer. This exhibition was installed in more than 30 cities in Central Europe. This is the example of our permanent exhibition, other photo exhibition. Here is the exhibition about the current state of Theresienstadt fortress, which is in very bad shape. More than half of the military buildings are now collapsing. So we use the photo exhibition for public awareness about this problem. This is also an example of the temporary exhibition, which is about the children at war, made by UNICEF. The famous photographers collected the exhibition. Sorry. Yeah. One of the most important use of art in our programs is theater. This is the theater performance based on the novel of Arnold Schlusstig, Holocaust survivor and writer. And this performance was installed in the train, in the real train, which traveled in Czech Republic, Slovakia, and Poland in years 2012 until 2016. And in 2017, we moved the train, the car, to Theresienstadt in the courtyard. So it is now used for other performance. Actually, this is the picture from the last scene of the theater play, which is based on the real story in the gas chamber, the revolt in the gas chamber in Auschwitz Birkenau. As for the literature, we work with writers. We do exhibitions about their books. We present their books, and also in 2012, we released the specific poem based on the let's say, research of the artist and reading the Hitler's Mein Kampf. And this poem with the music was also released on CD in 2013. Music is important tool or way how to represent especially the Roma genocide, because music is important for this community. So these are some examples of music performance, but also the classic music is performing in our programs, especially about the Theresienstadt, the so-called Theresienstadt composers. And this is our last project, or which nowadays is implemented in the Czech Republic. It is called the Lemkin Train, and it's dedicated to Raphael Lemkin and its life and his life and work. And inside the cars, there is a multimedia exhibition about Lemkin. So it's a combination of visual arts and multimedia program, which tells the story of Raphael Lemkin. And finally, we work with virtual reality. With our partner, the Smichov Technical School, we created the model of Theresienstadt, like digitized model, which is also accessible in virtual reality. So we can also talk about some artistic component of this this activity. This is the model of the prisoners of war camp in Theresienstadt during the First World War. So to sum up, our key art projects are Anschlusstick Train, the permanent and temporary exhibitions, Lemkin Train, and also a new permanent exhibition which will be open next year in the Wieser's house, and it will be about the universal genocidal behavior in humankind history. So we are open to new partners, new ideas, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Simon. It's impressive how you face this important mission of the acknowledgement of the history of genocide through this multimedia perspective and through all different kind of disciplines. We are going to listen to our second speaker, Mirosław Nizio. He's a founder of Nizio Design International, an architect and patron of culture with 30 years of experience in designing public spaces. The floor is yours. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you for invitation for this important debate. I'm representing, as you said, a firm, architecture firm, Nizio Design International. And it's happened that it has been 20 years we have been involving in developing a certain project as memorial, narration, complementation of exhibition. And it's important for the goal of my firm that we are doing for 20 years something which is important for all of us. It has been 18 years we finalized the project Uprising Museum in Warsaw. It has been 8 years we finalizing Pauline exhibition with the design and complementation of the interior of design. And we are in the process of a very important project for Ukraine, Holodomor Museum. But I'll begin at museum which I am touched very much because the tragedy in the past, in 20th century, and because the project was developing 12 years. It's about Michniów. It's a small village in Poland. It's a symbol of pacification of 300 villages in Poland. And it's happened that we develop not only memorial, but we develop museum, which is a kind of expression of something what happened in 1944. It's the essence of escalation of occupation, pacification of these villages. And on the picture you see the burning village. And my idea was to create something as a spine with screaming and getting distorted and destructed. It's made in concrete with physical attached of the wood as a part of the texture. And it's something, it's about victims and tortures and something about feeling about the time. And I think after these 20 years going through this narration, you can feel by all the senses, everything you can feel about that tragic history, 1944. This is some of the picture done a few months ago, because I said the project was taking 10 years. Like I always said, it's important project is taking time. And you can see during a different time how the project is reacting to the environment, how it's screaming, how it's telling the truth about the tragedy. And it's the end of the narration where you see this destruction of the villages, when you see the pictures printed on the steel with faces in front of you. And 300 crosses, it's actors which play very important role in this narration. Another project I got involved in my team, like I said, is a team of 25 people in my office. And in the past of 4 years, we are developing the very important memorial museum about the genocide 1932. And this is my first sketch. The important is that we are cooperating with the firm, Ukrainian firm Project System, and hires the English design company. And I'm in charge as a company from developing the architectural part, like interior part. This is my sketch showing how this structure of the building, it's telling the truth about the Holodomor. This is a sketch showing two layers of structure, soil, Ukrainian soil, and the tortures of regime, which trying to destroy the integrity of the Ukrainian culture. And this entrance, which is showing exactly the breaking, the cracking the roof, and during the night you can see the truth coming from inside. This is something which is important for symbolic of that memorial. As important is soil, black soil, in the narration of that museum. It showed the corridor, which showed the soil, expressing the dignity and the fighting for the freedom. And some of the exhibition as a pantheon, showing the culture, very important heritage, and everything which give this identity fighting for the freedom and giving everybody something which reflect past and the future. And we're on the point right now where we're thinking about changing the narration or the end of the narration because of the situation right now. So we're thinking about developing another story and deal with that. Another project which is not developed, but it's very important for me, it's a concentration camp which was during the war, Rogoznica. It's something which remind the empty space, a hole 35 meter deep, 100 wide, and it's reflecting to story about the surviving of the prisoners who got killed in that spot. And I divided this site into sections, historical and contemporary, by creating the wall as a barrier between light and dark, and the stairs which are directing to journey through this opening, finding about the truth about this context, and the space which give you space for reflection. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nizio. It's awesome, not only the monumental scale of your work, but also the commitment with the site and the space where you work. Now we have our third speaker, Zwizo. He's a British architect, artist, and filmmaker based in London, known globally for his emotionally charged work in diverse media. The Twilight Zone, oh my God.
Thank you.
The floor is yours, thank you.
Thank you for having me here today. And it's my honor to present to all of you today a very important art initiative by the European Parliament and the Platform of European Memory and Conscience. This art initiative is close to many people's hearts, and I would like to begin the presentation by sharing with you a very personal story. This photograph is showing me sketching in front of a 17th century derelict synagogue in a town called Snonim in modern-day Belarus. Snonim used to be a very vibrant Jewish town, but in 1941, the Nazi troops entered Snonim, and in just over a year, they've exterminated the entire Jewish population of 22,000, including my friend's relatives. The Nazis, they shot pregnant women in the belly, and they murdered children manually because they didn't want to waste their bullets. And this drawing was made in memory of the victims of the atrocity, as well as my friend's lay aunts and late uncles who never grew old. And as we all know, the story didn't stop there. Belarus lost a quarter of her population during the Second World War. Eventually, Hitler's army was defeated, but Stalin returned. It came with the creation of the Iron Curtain. Some Belarusian soldiers who fought alongside the Polish division decided to relocate to the UK in London, and they started a new life there. They've founded a boarding school teaching their children their native language, which was banned in their motherland. They've even converted one of the rooms in a house into a temporary church, continue to observe the religion they consider, continue to observe what they consider the national religion, which was the Eastern Catholic Church. It had always been their collective desire to one day to build their own church. Now, I was involved in the project, and they sent me to Belarus to look at their cultural heritage sites, and what I've learned was that the Soviet Union was the largest destroyer of cultural heritage. These were the drawings I made during my visit to Belarus. And eventually, they managed to build this wooden church in London, the capital of the UK, as a memorial to the turbulent history of Belarus, as well as a homage to the cultural, to their cultural identity. And at night, the little church will glow from inside, commemorating their ancestors who were burned alive inside those wooden churches and synagogues during the Second World War. Now, I'm sure these stories will resonate with many of you because they serve as reminders of the horrendous legacy of the evil Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact. And in 2009, after many, many years of debates and public hearing sessions, the European Parliament finally passed a resolution by an overwhelming majority to acknowledge Euro's totalitarian past, recognizing the singularity of the Holocaust, and calling for the creation of a pan-European memorial for all victims of totalitarianism. And the platform of European memory and conscience organized an international competition in 2017. They worked with Brussels city authority to identify a potential site for this memorial, and they've chosen Chaumray Square, named after a former president of the European Commission. And as you can see from this aerial photo, the site was strategically chosen due to its close proximity to all the major EU institutions. Because of my own experience, I felt compelled to submit a proposal to the competition, and these are the photos I've taken during my site visits. And as you can see, it's a normal public space in a bustling town in Europe. But if you go there, it's not like the synagogue I've just shown you, or even Auschwitz. It just doesn't carry the weight of history, because totalitarianism happened in multiple geographies. The site just doesn't embody the emotions of the victims, and it posted a major design challenge. Now, these are some of my early sketches when I was trying to come up with an idea, and I was really struggling because, as you can see, these are nothing more than empty architectural shapes. It says more about the author rather than the victims. And the breakthrough came when I noticed some words I've written down on a piece of paper. It says, beautiful, meaningful, moves heart. Now, those are not my words. Those are the words of Nina Winkelmann, the former managing director of the Platform of European Memory and Conscience. During the competition launch in the European Parliament, she mentioned she wanted to see those qualities in a new memorial. So my mind was preoccupied with this desire to bring the voices of the victims to Brussels, to central Brussels, to make that emotional connection with members of the public. During a site visit, I noticed this unknown man wearing a coat, carrying a bag, passing the square, and I was captivated by him. And somehow this image found its way to my unconscious mind, and it explained the reason why later I came up with this idea of a messenger. For me, the job of the designer was not to become a designer, but to be the messenger of the victims, collecting the last letters written by the victims to their loved ones, and came to the square scattering the letters all over the public space. Now, the concept is very simple and straightforward, everybody can understand, and the success of this memorial hinges on those real letters. And the process of soliciting those letters was really humbling. We've received the permissions to use tens of thousands of letters as such by institutions, public archives, and even private individuals who are related to the victims. We're not using the real letters as such, but instead we're going to use the enlarged images of the letters so that people could read clearly the letters from a standing position. We would then propose to use modern technology to print the images of those letters onto the paving blocks, and we repave the square with these paving blocks. Putting the images of the letters on the floor, on the ground, is not a sign of disrespect. And in fact, if you look around in medieval Europe, putting commemoration stones and even gravestones on church floors was a common practice. If anything, it was a very European thing. But more importantly, this memorial is a metaphor. The fact that our lives go on living in free Europe is due to the fact that we are the legacy of these victims. The irony is that Europe, despite being the birthplace of democracy, in the 21st century, right now at this moment, we still have dictatorship in Europe, and Ukrainians are dying every day in their search for freedom. This memorial is not about confrontation. You wouldn't see a Soviet-style monument sticking out from the ground. It's about reconciliation. Hopefully, the viewers will identify a letter written in her own language one day and make that emotional connection with the memorial. I do believe I have 1 or 2 minutes left. I just really want to take this opportunity to share with you 3 short letters from the collection. You don't have to do that, but I would encourage you to close your eyes and imagine these letters were written to you from your loved ones, by your loved ones from the prison cells. Now, the first letter, we don't know who wrote it. It was from the collection of the Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington, D.C. It goes, "My dear Manfred, I wholeheartedly congratulate you on your birthday. You have had to taste the suffering of the last few years. Your mother and your brother, both in an unknown place, will think of you with much anguish on this day. Since none of your parents, nor siblings, nor other relatives are able to surround you to help celebrate this day, I hope the soul family representative will endeavor to provide you with some joy." The second letter was written by a son to his mother in the prison cell. It goes, "Dear Mama, a sad presentiment tells me that we've met for the last time today. Dearest Mama, fate keeps on being cruel to you. This life of mine that together we have cherished so many times to the death finally manages to escape me. Please find comfort in the thought that I will be strong until the end. Certainly, I do not feel afraid. The only great regret in my heart is knowing that sister and you will be alone in this world." And the last letter was written by the relative of a friend of mine who was imprisoned in the Gulag in the Far East. By the way, the previous letter, the author was executed shortly after writing that letter. And this letter was written from Siberia, again addressing to his mother. It goes, "Dear Mama, one thing that's bad here is that it's overcrowded. We live with 70 people in a narrow barrack. I sometimes feel so depressed, and I don't know what to do. Mama said that I should save my health. That's the only way to survive here. God forbid you from falling ill. Then you can count that you are dead." And I will conclude my presentation with this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Siwei. Not easy to continue after these letters. Very touching. But we have our last speaker, last but not least. We have Piedad Solans. She's historian, theorist, and independent curator. Her work addresses a critical theory of violence and its structures through history and the visual arts. Author of the book Art and Resistance and curator of projects such as Technologies of Violence, War Machines, Wastelands, We Refugees, ETC. The floor is yours. Thank you.
Good morning, bon dia. It's a pleasure for me to participate in such a congress, and I want to say thank you for your invitation. I am going to speak in Spanish. If you want to put your headphones, please. The title of, perdón, el título de mi ponencia es Yo lo vi, resistencia, reparación. Yo lo vi, yo estuve allí, yo soy testigo.
I am a testimony.
A partir de la ilustración
from
de la
the illustration of the French, from the enlightenment, sorry, of the French Revolution, Marxist and liberal revolutions of the first half of the 20th century, the artist who was subordinated to power, depending from the power of the church and the power of aristocracy, monarchy, and the bourgeois, becomes a political subject immersed in the revolutionary events and becomes independent and free from this power in order to carry out the counter-representation of the representation he had made from power through beauty and through glorification of war, for example, and the sublimation, something that was hidden, the real face of power. The artist becomes a political subject, emerges as a political subject through his gaze, and turns his artistic work into a weapon. But the artist is not a killer. He's using his piece of art, his work of art, in order to attack injustice and to reveal the abuses of power, and immerse in the political events, himself victim of these events, and he is on the side of what we call the population or society. One of the first artists to emerge as a political subject, as a testimony, I saw it, I was there, you cannot deny it, there is not any possible interpretation of this fact, is Francisco de Goya, known by all of you in the disasters of war, where he reports the crimes and the destruction of war on the population and the capacity of resistance and also the vulnerability of society. How many corpses we still see today, and we have seen during the 20th century accumulation of corpses, and this is an engravure of the disasters of war of Francisco de Goya. I saw it, I was there in the 20th century in common graveyards, in the camps and fields, this immense piling up of dead bodies had continued and continued to exist in the 21st century. The German artist Otto Dix was in the First World War at the trenches, and he experimented as a testimony how far the human being can go when he's destroyed. The trenches war and the gas chambers, which are the gas masks, which are the death masks, are also engravers of the war 1920s by criticizing and reporting art as a weapon to report on the abuses and crimes of power. And on the right, we have an installation by John Herfield and Erwin Blumfeld, both of them, one German and the other one Dutch, Jews in exile, persecuted by the Gestapo and the Nazi regime, and it shows the authentic face of power in the face of Hitler. Is dead as a skeleton. And these photographs of Hitler, these pictures, were thrown as propaganda material by the Allied complaints on German cities in order to warn the population on the danger of death during the Third Reich. And the artist is actively participating because, as I said before, he's immersed in historical political war events in which he's also a victim. But he does it based on solidarity. On the left, we see Berlinese artist whose museum is in Berlin, Wie wieder Krieg, Never More the War. And we also see on the 30th of June, 1934, Heil Hitler. Hopes it's a wolf for the wolf, but not even wolves kill themselves among each other as it happened during that night. Hitler terror, artist reporting this butchery as portraying Hitler as a butcher. And wars, as you all know, create and lead to exile, displacement, and refugees, and thousands of people, masses of people without the citizenship, without rights, and vulnerable, and what was done with them. And this is one of the first camps surrounded in the south of France, where the Spanish exiled went, fleeing from the revenge of the Franco army after the Spanish Republic was defeated. The refugees, among whom we found members of the international brigades, are communist soldiers, socialist soldiers, Republicans. They were kind of welcome in this camp they themselves built, surrounded by these wires, the biggest threat of the 20th century, because it allowed the technique of confining and concentrating and putting under control, under surveillance, and when it was electrified, killing huge amounts of people as it never has been done in the history of the past. And in the goose camp, since 1940, we confined people who were called indesirables in French, people who, due to their condition or race, gypsies, homosexuals, communists. Hannah Arendt was there, Jana Marie was there, people who were refugees in France since 1933, fleeing away from the Nazi terror and the Gestapo, and artists such as John Turner, who were closed in this camp. And since 1940, with the defeat of Germany, beginning of the defeat of Germany at the Second World War, were deported from France to Auschwitz in order to be killed in the gas chambers. I saw it, I was there. Turner was also sent to Auschwitz, but we have his testimony. The artist as testimony, and this writer, communist writer, who was also in Auschwitz, very well known by all of you, who could not resist, although he was not sent to the gas chamber, but he committed suicide because he could not withstand the memory of what happened there, and he committed suicide in the kitchen of his home in Warsaw. Very interesting. Take a close look at everything. Do not feel defeated when you don't feel well, because maybe our mission here will be reporting to the world everything that is happening. Let the world know what's happening. He's a testimony, and to defend the dead. Defending the dead, here we have an oil painting, marvelous and terrible, of the German artist Brawler, where we see how the corpses were transported from Wurz to Auschwitz, the gaze, terrible gaze of that child who does not understand how defenseless those dead people are. And here they are reporting the participation of France, of the pro-Nazi Vichy government, who always deny his participation in this transportation, and they destroy all the archives in Gus. It was also called a confinement camp. It was a concentration camp. The artist I saw it was testimony of the French police participating in this transportation. And finally, Helga Wesova, the Czech artist who survived Auschwitz. His father, her father told her, paint what you see, and her drawings were seen as a testimony in the hearings against Nazi crimes. I'm going to go to what contemporary artists are doing, artists with whom I work, artists, international artists from all countries, and this is an exhibition that I organized with refugees on a text from Hannah Arendt that she wrote in New York on the condition of the refugees, nameless, worthless, languageless, without documentation also. And I followed this text for an exhibition in a museum in the north of Spain. What I want to highlight here is this poem by the Afghani star artist living in New York, Marian Ghani, "Your silence will not protect you," because silence means that that didn't happen, and this is why we cannot remain silent. The absence of language is not democratic. Democracy is the language. The Guernica by Picasso, and the Espanta de Málaga, one of the greatest crimes against the population of Spain. I'm going to move forward a little bit quicker now. This is a memorial I organized last year on 11,000 names of people who were concentrated at the Gurs camp, and my inspiration was those lists that you can see on the lower right hand of the transportation of the administration that allowed those crimes to be to happen, those massive killings to happen. And here we have the most recent exhibition, and the Sigable, the transportation to the exile, this huge map, a topography of the artist Cristina Lucas, three screens, 7 meters wide in the middle, a topography of the bombarding of Guernica and the current situation in Ukraine, and on the left we have the data, and on the right the registers, the visual registers through the century from Guernica to Ukraine. And this is the artist from Guatemala, Edegina José Galindo, performance in Castle, headquarters of weapons manufacturing, chased by a Leopard 1. We are now in Leopard 6. Regina Rosea Lindo denouncing and reporting genocides, walking on the streets of Guatemala with a container full of blood, stops in front of the institutions, puts her feet there and walks around the city reporting the crimes of Efraín Ramos, the dictator, the president, the genocide of the indigenous. Who can erase the footprints? This is the name of the performance. And finally, the Iranian artist living in Frankfurt, Paratsu Foruhar, working with symbols of beauty and iconography, symbols of Iranian writings. These are big installments in Casa Árabe, in Madrid and Cordoba. And the butterfly is the symbol of beauty and love, but when we look closer, we see it's made by people tortured, killed, and in prison. And finally, footprints cannot be erased and traumas cannot be forgotten. We see and we should pay tribute to our deaf people, but trauma cannot paralyze us. We should enlighten those who are alive, work with the population, the Afghanese artists in exile in London, works in performances where she recovers all the war artifacts, those instruments that have produced death, so they are used in war games. War games is the name of the work of art. Thank you very much for your attention.
Muchas gracias, Piedad. Gracias por este sintético repaso.
Thanks for this short historic summary. Through witness artists, witness that witnessed the horror of war and totalitarian regime.
Debate through a round of questions. And my first question is for both Nizio and Tszwai. And according to your long and successful careers, how is qualitative impact of artistic expressions of solidarity and resistance measure? I mean, what are the indicators of the impact of how it is influencing the society and the spectators or the public, the general public?
Generally speaking, almost 20 years, we have been dealing with creating memorial and narration of the past, of tragic history, because until 90, nothing happened. There were monuments, and our idea in our environment is to create something which impacts very much and educates in a way that we feel in all senses. This is example of Michniów, where the museum was created on the grave, which said about the memory, but nothing was explaining and nothing was educating about what happened and what we do to stop in the future of this tragedy. This is why I think the example of Mausoleum of Michniów or Mausoleum Museum of Polish Saving Jewish is something which stay forever in our minds. And in my idea is to create something as an expression of the feeling at the trauma, so it stays with us for the rest of our life. This is why it's important to have memories in the way as young people we understand, because we're different, living in different society and different interpretation of the past. This is the interpretation of artists, and my goal is to giving the truth about the past. And if I see this example of Chmielnik, where we actually connect with the Jewish in a way, how they felt, how they lived in the past before the war, and recreation of synagogue in some way as a art, as an installation, because it's important that we trying to, and it's my way, a goal to talk in universal language to understand how understands is the past. To understand the past, like I said before, and I mentioned once again, we can create anything, but without the witness, without the true story, which is not the written only part, which is very important. if we forget about that, and our goal is to create some type of artistic ideology by our own, it's not help. So when I saw the Jewish people, not the survivors, but family of survivors, who came to opening of the synagogue, when they saw the glass bima, which was a recreation of my artistic point, as a creation of something which play a main role in synagogue, when I look at the eye and the feeling of those people, I said, this is something which stay forever. I saw people crying, I saw people reminding the space before the war. This is, I think, say everything about the impact. It's no words.
Thank you. I don't know if Ziwe shares this opinion.
Well, I think art could serve as the soft power, and I don't honestly believe art alone could, you know, mobilize a nation to overturn a dictatorship or a totalitarian regime. But I do believe, I think it goes hand in hand. It depends on the context. I just really want to quote a very famous example. I don't know whether anyone in the audience remembers the singing protest in Estonia, for example. Just before the dissolution of the Soviet Union, you know, this mobilization of the mass and use their national way of expressing themselves in a very subtle way to protest against tyranny was rather powerful. And I think art in not a small way could really be that soft power to play a huge a role in terms of bringing people together on an emotional level. That's my short answer to your question. Hope that's okay.
Probably emotional level is what can measure the impact of the work. Yeah. My second question is for our two other speakers. And because you are probably in the other side of the performance, and from your professional experience, how does art shape our understanding of resistance and solidarity occurring in the past? I mean, how does art, what are the means of art to present and represent the facts of the past, but in terms of solidarity and resistance? According that you are a curator, writer, and you run all this center devoted and dedicated to spread the knowledge and the information of genocide.
So I can start. In my point of view and in my experience, art provides a different perspective of how to understand the genocidal events, war crimes, aggression. It is some optional view to the rational scientific description, and it is very important that it brings, like the art brings, some different language which is universal to all genocidal events, to all historical events, because everybody in the world understands what is death, what is the mass death. And in this respect, it brings some new perspective to also to solidarity, to resistance. It is the way how to understand people who were involved in resistance, in revolt, as I showed the example of the revolt in the gas chamber. It's this situation is very difficult to understand in like a rational way of thinking. So, and this artistic example, the theater performance, can help the audience to have some emotional, let's say, emotional understanding. So this is like from my perspective.
We have spoken about the role of artists. We have been speaking about the role of artists in Europe for two centuries or three centuries now. Artists are political subjects, considering that they are not only witnesses of historical events, not only they take part in resistance movements like in World War II. Today, for example, there are many artists working to underline the situation in the Arab world, in Guatemala, in South America, everywhere in the world. Here in Europe also, there are many exiled artists, so we have to take them into account, we have to engage with them. And it's not understanding the past. Me, as an historian, I don't see the past as a straight line, as a straight timeline with a past, a present, and a future. I see history as a 3D collage where many different events, fortunately,
Past.
And I believe it's contributing because they act as a bridge, they engage with citizens in performances, they criticize power abuse, and they work on trauma also. Thank you very much.
La duda es si,
of a work art can be questioned. Well, I don't think there is any questioning about the Goya war disasters, and I believe the artwork is extremely contemporary.
I'm sure there's a lot of questions and reactions in the audience, so we are going to have like 10 minutes for giving the voice to the audience. Please. Yeah, that I think he was first. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm Ion Ionita, editor in chief of magazine History in Bucharest, Romania. And congratulations for your presentations. We have two sides of the medal here. On the one side is the artist you have presented before, resistant artist against dictatorship and violence and genocide. And on the other side, we have thousands of artists who supported dictatorship and totalitarian systems and Nazism and communism. And they supported the cult of personality. You know, dictators have a very special relations with arts. They love to be presented in portraits, in statues and galleries. And my question is, how you make the difference? Are these artists real artists? Are their work art? How can ordinary people know to make a difference between two types of artists. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Who wants to answer the question of our colleague?
I can answer. Igualmente que ha habido una población colaboradora.
In all environments, there have been.
Al igual que ha habido una part of the population has supported
dictatorships and totalitarian regimes, and of course, there are also artists who are accomplices. With power in all contexts, and this cannot be denied.
But
from my opinion, they do not have the same visual and ethical and moral impact that those who denounce corruption
or those who use art
in a political and ethical way. They cannot be compared, from my perspective. The majority of such artists have not prevailed.
Picasso
has.
Blumenfeld
has artistas
en los campos,
artists
con ellos con quienes seguimos trabajando para recomponer la historia, para en los museos, para, y no con estos artistas colaboradores. Se puede hacer un análisis de esto, pero en mi opinión no tiene ningún sentido.
It makes no sense to, let's say, compare
como decir, una parte, la colaboración colaboró evidentemente.
Course,
una parte de quienes se llaman artistas colaboraron también
artists.
Por poder, por dinero, por ambición.
They did it out of their eagerness to earn money, out of ambition, etc. But I believe that what is ethically still relevant today is the historical and real presence of the artists that I present, for example, who become political subjects and not those who collaborated.
Gracias, Soledad. Anyone else in the table wants to add? If not, we're going to give the microphone. There was another board there, I think, and another one there.
Hello. Congratulations for all. Very beautiful. Very well done, all the presentations. And I wanted to ask you about what do you think about the art like a mirror? Because every time we are looking at everywhere, everyone talks about art in the other country. The war is there. We are showing the art because the problem is there. But at the end, it's our own problem. Because, for example, I was an artist long ago here in this country, 30 years ago. And every time I was showing what is going on, forward, before what's happening. Then when it's happening, it's like, okay. We almost kill you, but no problem. We continue. But why we are we cannot look in the past for learn what is going on after? Because for example, we have all this. You are showing all this happening, but it's happening again and again. Why? How we can cut this? This this round about going and again the same. Okay, we are looking, we are going to the galleries, we are showing the new architecture and happening again and again, and every place is totalitarianism. Everyone wants to say we have democracy, but at the end we know this democracy is not there. Then how we can manage it?
Are you addressing this question to a specific speaker? Okay.
So if I can answer, we know that art is very powerful in the stage of preparation and also the denial of different genocidal events. It is very powerful in terms of identification of the victim, identification of the enemy, of the chaotic creatures in religious stories and so on, and in the same manner, same way, the art is powerful in the genocide prevention. I would like to mention Franz Welfer's book, 40 Days of Musadak, which was released in 1933. It's about the revolt of victims of Armenian genocide, and it was amazing work of Prague-born German-Jewish author. He didn't have anything to do with Armenian history, and he really did it because of course Hitler came to power in that year. So both sides of artistic map are still active, and unfortunately the genocidal behavior cannot be stopped. It is something which is part of human nature, and if there are no people who will listen to artists, there will be no change. So it is not about artists, but about the audience.
Thank you. I think.
Werfel. Yeah. Today is 90 years anniversary.
Thank you. I think was someone at the end of the room. Yep. Okay.
Thank you very much. It's very inspiring. I have a, maybe it's not a question, it's a sort of reflection, or maybe I want to share with you some experience and knowledge of some place in Poland when this place that used to belong to another community, Jewish community, now is belonging to non-Jewish community, and it's in Seine. Seine is a small town located at the northeast of Poland. Before, in pre-war Poland, it's still that Polish terrain still, prolonged till Vilnius, further on into Lithuania. Anyway, that was populated by maybe 70%. It was Jewish, and of course they had a synagogue, and nobody of them remained for reasons we know. And that synagogue, in a rather dilapidated state, was then awarded to a new foundation, Borderland Foundation for crossing of cultures, ethnoses, and experience. And it's fantastic because they not only first invited, of course, existing Jewish musicians, and they renovated it, and they treat it as an art gallery, but very open. It's open for tourists who come, but nothing that happens around that synagogue is in a sort that could be perceived as too gay, too funny, too loud. Yes, they keep to a certain line of artistic expression. They also show exhibitions, and I think it's also thanks to them and thanks to some environment, some circles in Krakow, that in Poland the klezmer music, the Jewish klezmer music, enjoyed its revival, and it still enjoys it. So to put a conclusion to my now statement is that there are places of memory that for obvious reasons are very solemn and very serious places of mass death, yes, extermination. But also there are places that remind us of people who lived there and who were expelled, which are all over Europe. And I think maybe the case of Seine, the Pogranicze Center, the Borderland Center, is a good example how to live it, how to live it through, and how to blow new life into such places. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any reaction in the table to this comment?
There's a question.
No, she started saying it's more a comment than a question.
Okay. Yeah.
If not, we can continue with another question in the room. Yeah.
Thank you, and thanks very much for really interesting and thought-provoking presentations and insights into people's lives. So I just wanted to ask if any of you had used the theater of witness as a mechanism to enable people who have been in conflict, looking at people who have caused the conflict and people who have been victims of the conflict, and exploring that from an artistic perspective. So in Ireland, it's often been used in prisons and in different places. But in Ireland, as part of the conflict that we experienced over a number of years, that mechanism or that artistic expression has found to be very useful. And the other thing that I would say as well, in all museums and artistic installations, that it's really important that they don't become just a part of the buildings, that there is a dialogue with the generations and with young generations around what they mean, because we forget very easily. So, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Talk about the artists and the environment. You're right, it's not about memorial. It's about structure of the museum, which give interaction between past and the future. This is why Pauline Museum and synagogue is a place you can actually remind the community who lived before the war. And the goal for the revitalization of synagogue was to bring the past in a good way. Not bringing the Holocaust in the way, but bringing in the friendship, bringing the community who was before the war in the way how everybody imagined. So this is why our goal in our development of some memorial is to bring people who remember the good time. And this is important in every stage of our project. And it's important that we bring to this place the faces, the history of the past in the way how everybody could understand. And this is important.
Thank you. We are about to come to the end. One last question, very quick question before some final remarks from the table.
Lachudinsky from Austria. A quick question maybe to the two architects. What is your opinion about the question of monuments about people who were brought down in many countries, for instance, about people who discovered conquered new countries for European forces. After the communism, a lot of monuments were torn down. Now we have debates, for instance, in Vienna, we have a mayor who was rather anti-Semitic after the turn of the 20th century. So what would you think or propose? Is it, what do we do with these monuments? For instance, Christoph Columbus is also in a kind of wokeness topic. Is it enough that we put something on, or should we really destroy monuments as it was done in Britain? Thank you.
Wow, this is a very deep question, and the last question. I think it's, I think no one can really give a simple answer to that. Commemoration, a building memorial is a public display of commemoration and is usually state endorsed and is a very fluid process in the sense that what was acceptable some 20, 40, 30 years ago might no longer be the case nowadays. So I think you rightly pointed out Columbus still standing proud outside, and if you look at the Black Lives Matter movement recently, and I mean it's not just in Australia, I'm sure in every country in the UK, people are taking down you know, slave traders, statues and all that. You know, history, I mean, the OSA goes, all histories are politicized and all politics are historicized and is ongoing battle, really. It's a battle of narratives. And if you, you know, not far from here, if you look to Moscow, they have a totally different narrative to ours. So my answer to you is, I genuinely don't know, but I think we, you know, like you said early on, it's about bringing out the truth. I think what will stay eventually should be those memorials that speak the truth, and memorials for dictators and for tyranny and all that will eventually be torn down. And that's my answer to your question.
Thank you very much. Thank you to you all for all your contributions. And just to summarize all this session, I'd like to ask you for one key word regarding this solidarity and the power of art. One key important word to summarize in your opinion, your perspective, under your prism, this binomium. Shall we start from like in the panel, Simon?
Okay. So, well, I think that art enables us to have the solidarity with victims, and that's the main reason why, for example, why we use the art. And it is also important to note that the use of art should be balanced with scientific results and also the educational objectives or goals. And this process is based on the dialogue between scientists, artists, and educators, and this dialogue, in my point of view, is very productive.
Thank you.
I think that art is a very important instrument, a very important tool or armor to work with injustice, against injustice, for solidarity and cooperation also in the situations against dictatorships or situations of genocide, especially injustice. And the museums are today perhaps the most important channels to transmit memory and to transmit the trauma, but also to work with our present.
Thanks a lot.
I can actually tell my experience. Like I always said, if you only use the art to bring the past and bring the narration to the future, you have to be very responsible. If you're not ready, just don't do it. So this is my philosophy of bringing art to the memories.
I think my remark will be, art is most powerful if it genuinely touches people's hearts.
Thank you. Thank you very much to you all four and the audience. Thanks a lot.